this is it. The last chance to make the FARC-Off, the playoffs for the FARC Smash Beer Low Dollar Series Championship, is a doubleheader at the Texas Motor Speedway. And looking at the FARC-Off standings heading into the AXXELerating America Twin 76s, only four drivers can consider themselves locked in. Mark Thompson with his two victories coming at Elko and Darlington. And our three drivers in the top 10 points with a victory, Todd Stater and Kenny George, who have been trading the lead back and forth all season, and Lev Azarov coming off of his win last week at Salem. Johnson Clapp and Joshua Pacer are entered in this weekend's races, and with the equipment they have under them, they should safely lock themselves into the FARC-Off with smooth runs. Leslie Riggs and Mariano Zavala are not entered this weekend. We aren't even sure if they would come back to challenge for the championship if they remain in the top 40 after this weekend's races, but if they are bumped out of the top 40, they are out of FARC-Off contention, and everyone else will either need a victory or a smooth ride this weekend to remain in. Now for a quick look at the starting lineup, Thomas Tucker takes the Carl's P1 award in his return to the number 99 Ashcroft family racing car. Dan Maiato, the rookie who made his debut just a few weeks ago, with another very good qualifying run on the inside of row number 3, and SWH Racing puts all three of their cars, Danica Hollifield, Tyron Key, and Max Hollifield, in the top 10. And now a look at the back half of the field, a few debutants starting towards the back, George Hawkins and Ryan Forrest, as well as a few FARC-Off hopefuls that don't need to be starting as deep in the field as they are, namely guys like Dan Lechleiter, Riley Durbin, and Kevin Monroe, as well as Stanley Parsons starting on the outside of row 14 there. And we have another FARC-Off hopeful in Tristan Kristoff, who failed to qualify for this race, though it's not terribly surprising when you consider that he was driving the Team Burr car. He's been taking a few rides with Team Burr after his Road America win, desperately trying to hang on to a spot in the top 40. But good news for Kristoff, as well as everyone else in this DNQ list. The rules for the doubleheader races this season state that any driver who fails to finish race number 1 will not be allowed to start race 2, and their spots will be taken by the drivers who initially fail to qualify. So while I'm hoping these guys won't be wishing for misfortune on their competitors, I'm sure they would at the same time jump at the opportunity to get back onto the track for race 2 and get themselves some track time and points. We now take you trackside for the start of race number 1. The pace car leaves the field in the hands of Thomas Tucker, the younger brother of Ashley Tucker, with his third consecutive start inside the top 10, and I believe his first career pole. He gets a pretty good jump over Billy Ray Smith Thompson on the inside line there as they head into turn number 1, but here comes Danica Hollifield inching forward, pulling even with the 99. A little bit of drafting help possibly from the 82 of Lev Azarov and the 09 of Jason Bates. And Hollifield will clear the 99, heading into turn 3 and start to pull away. Thomas Tucker sliding up the track a little bit, letting Billy Ray Smith Thompson in. And Thomas Tucker is going to drop all the way to about 5th or 6th. He can't seem to get going at the start here, but we get a quick caution on lap 3 as Greg Gray and Bradley Carlisle get together and go spinning to the inside. Both drivers would continue, but that damage is going to hurt their race pace. Lev Azarov finds his way to the lead after the restart, only to be challenged by Tyron Key, the rookie in car 51, followed by another rookie, Dan Maiato, car 462. On the inside there, Azarov stands to lose a couple more spots as Danica Hollifield gives him a challenge, but Azarov's gonna hang around the outside, give Hollifield a run for her bunny as you see Maiato now making a run for the lead. Riley Durbin goes around and brings out another quick caution after contact with the 5 of Mike Malone. Lev Azarov stood to continue leading on the restart, but a tire goes down on car 82 under caution. Not the way he wanted to continue after his first career win at Salem last week, but he's solidly in the top 10 in points, solidly in the FARC-Off. So not a whole lot to lose for Lev Azarov as they see Danica Holifield assume the lead, but Kira Smith and Trek Tauger are going to interrupt the action once again. Trek Tauger getting caught up in the mess between Kira Smith and Ryan Forrest in the 60. Another caution after the restart. Kurt Walker runs right to the back of Kenny George. Second in points coming into this race. And more cars are coming as George tries to get back going. And he gets an unwanted boost from the 86 of Gio Arias, the 2015 FARC Super Series champion. But Arias in the Ike Durbin car has struggled this season. And that's a pretty accurate description of how Arias' first full Smash Beer Low Dollar Series season has gone. Nowhere to go. Didn't even see the 50 until the last second. Another restart, another caution. Bob Steffens and Todd Stater, the points leader, get together. And that's about a six-car pileup. You saw the Power Surge teammates, Jim Kidd and Billy Bob Childers, get together, as well as Taylor Brillen and Johnson Clapp. Clapp trying to stay in the top 40. Does not need incidents like this. Lap 39, the halfway mark. The battle for the lead is on between Jason Bates and Chuck Johnson. Chuck Johnson goes around the 09. Mike Malone is going to follow through for a second. Bradley Carlisle trying to get his lap back. Does himself no favors by hitting the wall. Lev Azarov follows Tyron Key into the wall. And another small pileup ensues. Billy Bob Childers up and over the 63 of Kevin Monroe, Kurt Walker, and Joshua Pacer also involved. Billy Bob Childers planted that car back on all fours and tried to drive away, but that car is toast. He gets a little help onto his roof thanks to Joshua Pacer and rolls right over the top of the 63. Billy Bob Childers will go out of the race. That car is heavily smoking. 2016 has really been a struggle for the Sergio Power team after many years of success, including two series championships with Rip Tyler, but all of their drivers jumped ship to Trans Am after William Power opened up a new team in that series. Billy Bob Childers and Jim Kidd came back to FARC, but they haven't found a whole lot of success yet, and they look to possibly be missing the FARC-Off, and Ashley Tucker might be missing the FARC-Off if she doesn't find some speed this weekend, but she's now driven into the top five. I've heard some rumblings that if Tucker misses the FARC-Off, M&J Racing is going to replace her in that 64 car with Mark Thompson, who has locked himself in. Dan Lechleiter is another guy fighting for that FARC-Off spot, trying to put a lap on Riley Durbin. Lechleiter currently running in 8th place. Stanley Parsons, that 427 car, in 9th. And we get another caution. Kenny George goes for another spin after contact with John Burr shortly before lap 50, coming to 25 to go. So that's gonna set up a pretty close battle for the top half of the field. Chuck Johnson continuing to lead the way. He's got the entire top five breathing down his neck. You can put a blanket over these guys. Mike Malone leading the charge. Ashley Tucker up to third now. These guys all waiting for something to inevitably go wrong with the 46, knowing that team's luck this year. But now something's going to go wrong for Stanley Parsons as he gets together with Danica Holifield. Kenny George hard into the side of the 427. Here comes more cars. They all dart to the inside of the 427. George struggling to get back going, but Trek Tauger clobbers the 50, and Kira Smith is going to finish off the 89. Poor Kenny George. It seems like he's been involved in every other crash this race. Anthony Griffith, an innocent victim and all that. George struggling to limp away. Here comes Trek Tauger. Big impact from the 74. And Kira Smith joins in the fun as well. Kira Smith always seems to be getting in the same messes that Trek Tauger is getting into today. Lap 62 now, 15 to go. And Chuck Johnson actually has a bit of a cushion on this restart. He's got a couple lapped cars in between him and the rest of the field, Bradley Carlisle and Dan Maiato. But here comes Mike Malone using the 462 as a pick to get by the 64. Thomas Tucker making his way back up to third, but you see the caution lights on once again. Anthony Griffith, way too hot through turns one and two, and stuffs Joshua Pacer into the wall. Pacer, another one of those FARC-Off hopefuls with a win and trying to stay in the top 40 in points. Lap 68 now, 9 laps to go on this restart. Chuck Johnson continuing to lead the way. Mike Malone breathing down his neck. Here's Lawrence Burren, the 62 for M&J, who has now made his way up into the top 5. Lawrence Burr has been in FARC racing for many years. He has struggled to get himself a solid full-time ride. He did run the full Super Series last year with M&J Racing, and now he's having a go at the Smash Beer Low Dollar Series on a limited basis with this team, and he's finally being able to show what he's got with that M&J equipment. The son of everyone's favorite backmarker, John Burr. Speaking of John Burr, here he is, running inside the top 20, and it always feels good to see that 54 running in the top half of the field, still on the lead lap, but here comes Greg Gray to challenge him for the 19th spot. Greg Gray, after that first wreck, has struggled, and you see how much that's impacted him. Even getting by the 54 is a chore. Mike Malone, right on the back bumper of the 46, trying to pressure him into a mistake, but knowing Chuck Johnson and Cat Motorsports, something's gonna go wrong without Mike Malone's help. To say that the Catherine Azure-owned 46 has struggled with bad luck over the past few seasons is an understatement, as Johnson runs wide. He hits the wall off of turn two. Johnson into the wall from the lead. Mike Malone scoots by, and he's already cleared him by about 15 car lengths. And there's the mistake from Chuck Johnson that we all knew was coming. And with less than 5 laps to go, no less, Mike Malone now staring down his first career win and a possible spot in the FARC-Off. That would be huge for Mike Malone, who comes all the way from Los Angeles to run these races. But wait a minute, Chuck Johnson is running him back down. 3 laps to go now, and Johnson is on him like a raging bull. Mike Malone might find himself in the wall if he isn't careful. Oh boy, hitting that wall must have knocked something into place for Chuck Johnson. He is driving like a man who has had enough of the garbage that has been piled onto him this season. All the crashes, all the mechanical failures. Johnson is sick of it. Cat Motorsports is sick of it. And now he takes the lead. Once again, with just 2 laps to go. Now, can he hold on? Is something else gonna go wrong? Johnson sliding up the track once again, but he keeps it off the wall this time. Mike Malone struggling to hang on. Mike Malone must have burned off all of his stuff. Johnson now on the white flag lap. He rounds the final corner without incident. That car is still going full bore to the finish line. Chuck Johnson scores his first FARC Smash Beer Low Dollar Series victory. First victory for Cat Motorsports. All the heartbreak, all the repair bills, finally no longer in vain, as Chuck Johnson with his victory locks himself into the FARC-Off, and he will be challenging for this championship. Thomas Tucker got by Mike Malone for a second at the last minute, but still, very good result for Mike Malone, even though he fell off at the end there. A lot of the multi-car teams have something to smile about from this race. SWH Racing just barely missed out on getting all 3 of their cars inside the top 10. Tyron Key in the 51 finished 11th. Jason Bates and Johnson Clapp, the 2 James West cars, 6th and 7th. And Lawrence Burr and Ashley Tucker, 4th and 8th for M&J Racing. And that 8th place finish is especially good for Ashley Tucker, trying to make it into the FARC-Off and possibly keep her job. Now, moving into the second round of today's doubleheader, the starting lineup for race two will be exactly the same as the results of race one. Chuck Johnson will get the 20 bonus points for starting on the pole of race number two. The only difference will, again, be that the drivers who dropped out of race one will be replaced by those who failed to qualify at the start of race two. And those drivers who failed to qualify but are now getting back in are highlighted in yellow at the back of the grid, starting with Art Gordon in the 91 for Laser Motorsports. Tristan Kristoff in the 68 for Team Burr will get back onto the track and try to score himself some much-needed points. And Tom Brayton will start shotgun on the field. And once again, we go trackside to bring you the start of race number two. Chuck Johnson leads to the line to start race two, but he struggles to get going as Thomas Tucker gets a much better start than the last race and jumps out to the lead. Johnson drops back to fourth as Lawrence Burr moves to second and Jason Bates moves into third. Unfortunate for Johnson after his big win just a few moments ago, but Thomas Tucker picking up right where he left off after finishing second and pulling away from the field, or at least trying to pull away. There's that orange 777 car of Max Hollifield running him down. Max Hollifield's only other FARC start was at Daytona, where he finished 33rd with a DNF, but he rockets around the outside of Thomas Tucker for the race lead. Looks like Tucker may have burned off all of his stuff too early. But Max Hollifield now pulls away as Thomas Tucker falls into the clutches of Bob Steffens. But Max Hollifield looking to pull away in one of the few FARC opportunities he's getting this season. Speaking of opportunities, here's Art Gordon after getting into race number two, driving his way up into the top 20, although not without its struggles as he gets into the side of Jason Bates. And you see Todd Stater has hit the wall. He's holding up Art Gordon and a few other cars as well. Bradley Carlisle trying to get by. And Art Gordon's now going to lose a few of the spots that he's worked for since the start of this race in the struggling Laser Motorsports car. Here's Tristan Kristoff running 31st in the Team Burr car, getting into race two after picking up a spot from one of the drivers who was eliminated. This race is Kristoff's last shot to make the FARC-Off. If he can keep the car clean and pick off a few spots due to attrition, he will be able to qualify in a Team Burr car, no less. I know Team Burr will be all over that accomplishment, getting into championship contention with one of their cars. Only with a system like the FARC-Off can we see stories like this unfold, and Kristoff is doing exactly what he needs to do. Bob Steffens tries to run down Max Hollifield, but he struggles to get by the 04 of Harv Henry. Max Hollifield, on the other hand, has been having a very easy time getting around these lapped cars. Thomas Tucker on the inside of Bob Steffens for second place. Tucker trying to make his way back up the running order after taking the lead early and then dropping back. Tucker does seem to have a very good car overall. It's just consistency that he seems to be struggling with today. Chuck Johnson has settled into a groove. He's down in fifth right now after starting on the pole and dropping back immediately. Now hounding Mike Malone for fourth. The Malone-Johnson battle the other way this time around, as Riley Durbin running in seventh has to hit the pit lane for an unscheduled stop, and he's going to lose a lap in this race as well. We're at about lap 21 now, and here comes Max Hollifield going by, and you're gonna see just how big of a lead he has right now. These are all lapped cars, and there's Thomas Tucker, that green car, in second. So Max Hollifield has now built himself roughly a 5-second lead in these first 20 laps. I bet he'd hate to see a caution right now, but with all these lapped cars mixing it up with the leaders and some cars bouncing off the walls, yep, there it is. Dan Miato gets into the side of Kyler Spavital, Anthony Griffith, and George Hawkins get involved as well. Ashley Tucker! Wow, a big, big hit for the 64 into the 762 of George Hawkins, making his series debut this weekend. That car just takes flight clear over the 07, and Taylor Brillen joins in the fun as well. George Hawkins comes to a rest on his roof. He would climb out of that car, but Ashley Tucker, in her last chance to make the FARC-Off, really did not need to go barreling into the side of Hawkins. Meanwhile, Max Hollifield's 5-second lead has now been erased, and now he's got all these lapped cars to deal with on the restart, and the rest of the field is breathing down his neck. Bob Steffens follows him past Michael Day and Zach Webster. Wow, Zach Webster in that 41 has barely found any speed this season. He's only been good on the road courses. Other than that, he's been running around 30th, if not failing to qualify. And there goes Bob Steffens to the lead. Bob Steffens still searching for his first series victory after about 10 years in the series with an off year or two. But now he gets challenged by Greg Gray in the 78. Gray to the lead. But Danica Hollifield is going to bring out the caution after getting together with Tristan Kristoff and taking Troy Peterson with her. Hollifield ran very well in race one, but she was running 20th at this point here in race two. After the restart, Zach Gott starts making a charge towards the front. 2016's been a bit of a struggle for Gott in Gravity Racing. Darlington was his best race, where he finished fourth after leading 25 laps, but other than that, not a whole lot of success. And he is going to need a win if he wants to advance to the FARC-Off. Johnson Clapp, running in fifth in the James West car, doing exactly what he needs to do to maintain his FARC-Off spot. Clapp established himself as a force to be reckoned with even before his win at 70-77. He dominated the first half of Elko, as we see Mike Ballone and Riley Durbin getting into a hard crash. Several of the backmarkers piling in. Zach Webster, Ryan Forrest, and here come a few more cars. Truman Ellison, Art Gordon, and Tom Brayton. A lot of the cars that failed to qualify and got in through race two. That opportunity for them not really working out too well. The next caution, with about 25 laps to go, Michael Day runs straight into the back of Harv Henry, as if he didn't even see him. Yes, Michael must have been daydreaming. You can demand that I apologize for that all you want, but I refuse to. After the restart, Johnson Clapp tries to pick up a couple more spots using the 83 of Todd Lacey as a pick to get by the 7. Todd Lacey in that 83 car finally makes a race, and he will probably be booted from that team after this weekend. Though it'll be interesting to see what Desert Star does afterwards, because Lacey is bringing the primary sponsorship this season. Here's a driver who doesn't deserve to be booted from his ride, Lawrence Burr, on his way to getting another top 5 in that 62 car today. Dan Mayotto back up to second, but he gets held up by Tom Brayton, and Johnson Clapp gets him sideways. He saves it, but that kills their momentum. Here comes Lawrence Burr. I'll just be splitting you guys down the middle. Thank you very much. Lawrence Burr takes over second, and here comes the rest of the field to swarm all over these guys. Mayotto continuing to be held up by the 100. He's going to lose several more spots. Kurt Walker now gets stuck behind the 100, but Johnson Clapp, battling back, tries to get second from Lawrence Burr. They split Tom Brayton. Clapp and Burr dead even through 3 and 4, and now Burr's got the edge over the 69. Burr is going to keep second place, coming to 6 laps to go. In the meantime, Greg Gray has remained unopposed through these final laps, though he hits the wall on the white flag. He's got a comfortable lead. He doesn't need to be making any risks like that. But he soldiers on. Greg Gray in the Ken Groves Racing Machine for the first time since Daytona is going to take his first FARC Smash Beer Low Dollar Series victory. And despite making so few starts this season, Greg Gray will land himself a spot in the FARC-Off with his victory. Kelly Spicen made a last-minute charge to finish in second, so even though her teammate Zach Webster struggled throughout the weekend, Spicen still brings home a very good result for AXXELerator Motorsports. Lawrence Burr grabs another top five finish. Johnson Klepp, Joshua Pacer, and Bob Steffens have very good points days. Chuck Johnson, the race one winner, fell back a little bit further, but still had a pretty solid points haul with the 20 bonus points for winning the pole. And how about Todd Lacey, Tristan Kristoff, and Mason St. Martin? Three guys who struggled for speed all weekend, but picked their way through the carnage to grab top 20s for themselves. And with that, the FARC Smash Beer Low Dollar Series regular season is over. It is now time to begin the road to the championship. Here are the 15 drivers who have qualified for the FARC-Off. Mark Thompson, Todd Stater, Lev Azarov, Kenny George, Chuck Johnson, Johnson Klepp, Joshua Pacer, Greg Gray, Tristan Kristoff, and Leslie Riggs have qualified for the FARC-Off based on their victories. And Bob Steffens, Dan Lecklater, Billy Ray Smith Thompson, Bradley Carlisle, and Kevin Monroe make up the rest of the FARC-Off on points. Mariano Zavala, Stanley Parsons, and Monica Rook, who were eligible entering the Twin 76s, have unfortunately been bumped out. But now, these 15 drivers will duke it out for the next three race weekends until the doubleheader at the Grand Detour Raceway in Quincy, Illinois. After that, five drivers will be eliminated, and the remaining 10 will do it all over again for the three races after that. And then after Talladega, we will be left with the final five who will fight for the title at Texas World, and the highest finisher among them in that one race will be the 2016 FARC Smash Beer Low Dollar Series champion. Here's how this is going to work. The three magic numbers that these 15 drivers will need to concentrate on over these last seven races will be wins, points, and average finish. If you win a race, you will automatically advance to the next round. If you don't win a race, your second option to advancing to the next round will be the number of points you have. But if you don't have enough points to advance to the next round, then your last resort will be your average finish. After Quincy, the final race of the round of 15, regardless of the number of winners, the next six drivers will advance to the round of 10 on points, and then any remaining spots will be filled by the drivers with the highest average finish. But it's going to get a little trickier going from the round of 10 to the final five after Talladega. If none of the four races of the round of 10 are won by FARC-Off contenders, then the top three on points will advance, followed by the top two on average finish. If there is one FARC-Off winner during the round of 10, then two drivers will advance on points and average finish each. Two winners will mean the top two in points advance, followed by the one driver with the highest average finish. Three winners means that only the driver with the most points and the driver with the highest average finish will advance as well. And if four different FARC-Off contenders win all four races, then they will only be joined by the next driver with the highest number of points. So if that's the case, and you were banking on your average finish, you're out of luck. I'm sure we are all eager to witness the battle that will unfold with this new championship format. The next race, the very first race of the FARC-Off, will be the Joe's Tree and Lawn Care 100 at the New Hampshire Motor Speedway. And you can catch all the highlights right here on the FARC Racing Network.